Isaiah chapter number 14. 14th book of the Bible is 2 Chronicles. For the Lord will have mercy on Jacob. So get that. God is not done with him. And will set. Let's see what that letter is. And yet choose Israel and set them in their own land. Oh. No matter what the United Nations say, no matter what the Arabians say, the Bible records that the mouth and hand of God, you know, you don't believe it, I don't care. I believe this is the very word of God, the God that created all men. As far as that piece of land over there, it is their own land. That's what God said. You don't like it? That's tough. You follow that with Genesis chapter 12. I will curse them that curse thee and bless them that bless thee. You just might as well, as a nation, you want to do right before God. Give that land to the Jews. Get the Gentiles out of it and protect them to the fullest. And wipe out any nation, any group of people that try to make that void. And you'll get God's blessing. You give that land to the Jews right now, and let's say the Philistines go over there and try to conquer. You just nuke the Philistines. How cruel. No, that's God. By the way, that's what God told Israel when they went in the land. Destroy them all, which they didn't do. And the strangers shall be joined with them. Alright? Strangers. There's Gentiles. Those who want to do right. Israel was to be a lighthouse to all the world. If you ever wanted to serve the God, not gods, if you wanted to know about God, Jerusalem would be, or should have been, that lighthouse that all were to go and grab hold of a Jewish person and say, what do I do? That was practiced throughout the book of Acts. There was 12 Jews that went out in all the known world preaching and teaching about God, Jesus Christ. One man asked Paul and Silas, what must I do to be saved? And they gave him an answer. It's going to be like it in the millennium. All the people are going to grab hold of the Jews. The Bible says, come, let us go with you, for you are the ones of God. And they'll come to Jesus Christ. That's what it was supposed to be like. It wasn't supposed to be no dumb with a rock there. Israel was not supposed to serve the heathen gods. They were supposed to serve God, and the heathens were supposed to forsake their gods. And they shall cleave to the house of Jacob. Not Americans. Not Germans. Israel. And the people shall take them and bring them to their place. And the house of Israel shall possess them in the land of the Lord for the servants and for handmaids. And they shall take them captives, whose captives they were, and they shall rule over their oppressors. You know, Egypt had Israel as slaves. Babylon took them captive. There's coming a time in world history, world future. There's coming an event where the Jewish man will be in charge. And all those will be under the Jewish people. In Jerusalem. Under the Lord Jesus Christ. You're going to reap what you sow. They have been putting Israel under the burdens. So God will put them under the burdens. You better get and learn one principle in life. You're going to reap what you sow. And it shall come to pass in the day that the Lord shall give thee rest from thy sorrow, from thy fear and from the hard bondage wherein thou wast made to serve. Thou shalt take up this proverb against the king of Babylon, who is a type of the Antichrist, and say, how has the oppressor ceased? The golden city ceased. Now, Daniel, I gotta ask you to forgive me, I've been sick. Daniel has not happened. Yet you're already told what Nebuchadnezzar is going to do. Throw him into the den of lions. Throw him into the furnace of fire. And that's just not it. That's not just two stories. I guarantee there was much trouble and anguish in Babylon, like there was in Egypt. And there's one thing that you get from the Egyptians, the story about the Jews. They were hard workers. When Joseph brought his family to Pharaoh, you seek out men in your family who will work for me. Even though the Egyptians made it worse for them, they didn't give them the hay. They had to go find. They went out and found their own hay and made brick. They just didn't make enough. The Jews are hard workers. The golden city ceased. Nebuchadnezzar made a golden statue. The Lord has broken the staff of the wicked and the scepter of the ruler. The leaning, the rod of authority. He who smote the people in wrath with a continual stroke. He that ruled the nations in anger is persecuted and none hindereth. God is going to get to the nations what the nations have done. And for God, he's just going to swipe his hand over. The moral for any world leader that hears this message, the moral for any human being that hears his message. One thing, if you want to please God, you better leave those Jews alone. You better help them out as much as you can. You know, how can you leave them alone and help them out? You better not do them any injustice. You better not do them any wrong. And you better do all the right that you can. And you got to remember, God's plan of salvation today is in a Jewish man. The Lord Jesus Christ was a Jewish man. And the Bible proclaims you are to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ to be saved. Plain and simple, that's it. How can someone of the KKK be saved by Jesus Christ when they abhor the Jewish people? And yet they put up crosses. Stupid, don't you realize that if you abhor the Jews, you abhor Jesus Christ, because John chapter 1 says that the Jewish people are his brethren. If you don't have a Jewish Jesus, you don't have the salvation of God. I don't care who you call yourself. I don't care what you call yourself. And you better treat those Jews right, in word or deed. You don't have to do. Joab's brother did not have to kill. Oh, the Bible records that Joab and his brother killed this one man. He was thinking about it. Ahab or Ahaz, forget which one is, Jezebel's husband, did not kill Naboth. But he allowed his wife to have the authority to kill Naboth. And God said, hey, go see that murderer. Wait, he didn't do it, his wife did it. Yeah, but God will charge you. Jesus said, whosoever looketh upon a woman and lusts after in his heart has already committed adultery. You don't have to do it. You don't have to physically grab a Jew and kill him, but man, if you think about it, you're charged. Go through the Bible and find where just by thinking, just by talking about it, God says you're guilty. Paul, New Christian, New Testament Christian, under the church age says you're to pray for peace in Jerusalem. They are your enemies for the gospel's sake, but you're not. You're to pray for them. I don't know any Jewish missionaries, but my prayers is for somebody who God knows who is working with a Jewish people or a Jewish individual for salvation. And then in turn, God plays a big joke on the Jewish people. Imagine a Jewish person having to take Christmas off from work. Now, isn't that a big joke? They reject the Messiah, but yet they got to take Christmas off. And yet this country does not celebrate any Jewish holidays. When was the last time your employer said, okay, you get the Passover over? Oh. We got to have you work the Purim, but we're going to pay you extra for working the Purim. Why are all America, the Christian nation, why are they always celebrating the heathen and not the Jewish God? The whole earth is at rest. Can you say that right now? And it's quiet. Here is, as you're listening to this right now, on the other side of the world, there could be American troops being shot at. In Afghanistan or Iraq, or they're shooting at somebody. You know, somewhere right now in the world, in a hospital room, someone is screaming out in pain. They break forth into singing. That goes on. I mean, turn on the radio, but that's not for the glory of God. We're talking about the glory of God. Imagine turning on any radio dial and there would be the glory to God. That ain't happening. Even Christian radio, Christian stations don't give God the glory. There'll be coming a day when you walk through, if there are going to be grocery stores, I don't know, in the millennium, there'll be praising music to God. Yea, the fir trees rejoice that day. Now, what's that mean? I take that literal. I don't know if I'm supposed to. There are places in the Bible that says that the trees will clap their hands. I can be wrong. You don't have to believe. I really believe. I believe somehow the trees are going to rejoice. And the cedars of Lebanon saying, cedars of Lebanon. Now, men are likened to trees in the Bible. Since thou art laid down, no filler is come up against us. The great cedar trees of Lebanon are not being cut down for their splendor. They were used for the temple. They were used for the king's houses. They say even today, you know, most of the cedars of Lebanon today have been, you know, are gone. There's not many left. Well, one day they'll be happy when the trees say, hey, they're not cutting us down no more. Then we get into a passage. Hell from beneath. I guess the Bible believes in hell. Because it says hell. Where is it? It's beneath. Hell from beneath is moved for thee to meet thee at thy coming. Talking to somebody. It, hell, stirs up the dead for thee. There are dead people in hell. Even all the chief ones of the earth. Famous military leaders, great statue of people are in hell. All over the earth. It has raised up from their thrones all the kings of the nations. So hell has world leaders. You want to meet a pope? You'll meet one in hell. You want to meet a king? You'll meet one in hell. You want to meet a president? You'll meet one in hell. You want to meet an ambassador? You'll meet one in hell. So position in the earth doesn't give you salvation. You can't say, I'm going to heaven because I'm a world leader. Because some world leaders are put in the position, according to Matthew 4 and Luke 4, by falling down and worshiping Satan. Not all, but many are. All they shall speak and say unto thee. Who is the thee? Art thou? The thou is a thee. This person we're talking about. Also become weak as we? This person that is thrown into hell, everybody gathers up and gathers around him and say, hey! You're just like one of us, Mr. Big Boy. Mr. Smarty Pants. Now you're weak. Art thou become like unto us? Burning in hell? Thy pomp, that splendor possession, look at me. And you put all your doodads on. And everybody, look at who's coming. Here comes the presidential motorcade. And how can you tell the presidential motorcade? You got 40,000 million cops, 40,000 million limousines, and all the splendor, everyone lined up. That's a pomp. You know, when the kings and queens in England, they get out and they got their carriages and their nice splendid horses and all that, that's a pomp. And when you get in a Catholic church, and here comes this little procession, the priest all the way up to the front of the church, and you know, the smoking, that's a pomp. It's brought down to the grave. Your possession, your splendor is brought to the grave. So what do you have when a lot of these people die? You have this great funeral possession. And the noise of thy vials, an instrument. The worm is spread under thee, and the worms cover thee. Death. Death. Now, we can't stop there. Because then we'll lose who we're talking about. And we'll pick up the next five verses, then we'll probably quit. Five being death in the Bible. And it says in verse 9, hell is moved for thee, for thy coming. It stirs up the dead for thee. It says in verse 10, for thou say unto thee, art thou become weak as we? Art thou become like unto us? Thy pomp. Now who are we talking about? Verse 12. How art thou fallen from heaven? Oh, thou. We still got the same person we're talking to. It's the same subject. That thou is past tense. But it will happen again. Revelation 12. Job 1 and 2 tells us that there is a being that still goes up to God even though he's fallen. After Revelation 12, he will never go back before God. But let's read on. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer? That's what we've been talking about. Latin, lux, is for light. Furrow, to bring light. So I seen this light when I was dying. You better be very careful. the light at the end of the tunnel. Even the Bible records that Satan makes himself as an angel of light. And he's never called an angel. He's not an angel. He's a cherubim. Ezekiel 28. He's never an angel. And he has something to do with light. He's an imitation of the light, John chapter 1. So these people who come back and say, you know, I've seen the light and I died and all that, you better be very careful, because I don't think you've seen the Lord Jesus Christ. Because no man has seen him in this period. Jesus Christ is not going to show himself and reveal himself. He does it by the word. We don't do dreams no more. We don't do visions no more. We have a completed Bible. Now you better look out for this Lucifer, who is an arch enemy of God, who will do everything in his imitation to get you to believe in a false God, thinking you're serving God, called religion. Son of the morning. World system. Son of the morning. Sunrise service. That is found in Jeremiah as an abomination to God. How art thou cut down to the ground? Satan's walking around on the ground right now. Job 1 and 2 says he's walking up into the throne of the earth. If God were to give you spiritual eyes open, you wouldn't believe what you'll see. I believe if he were to open our eyes, I bet you it would just scare the fire out of you. Ezekiel, I'm not Ezekiel. Elijah said one time, open his eyes, Lord. He opened up his eyes, he saw chariots of fire and horsemen. There's more than what you can see. That's why you have to be very careful when it comes to magic and illusions. Making something look like what it's not. That's Satan. I don't care what you say. I don't care how much you praise and glorify and give God the glory. That's Satan. When something looks like and it's not. You think God does that? You think God makes something look like and what it's not? That's not God. Because it's a lie. And God cannot lie. Which didst weaken the nations. America, the Christian nation, not under Satan, it's not. He weakened the nation. He's making this nation think that sodomites are okay. And if you're against the sodomites, you're the bad one. That's complete defiance of the Bible that is supposed to be in every schoolroom. That's supposed to be in every courtroom. That should be in the president's Oval Office right next to his presidential bed. And on board his aircraft and in his helicopter. It's supposed to be in every hotel room. Imagine a nation having a Bible in a hotel room where a man and woman is going to go fornicate. Or even adulterize each other. With a Bible in the drawer. See, you can't use a Bible as a magical sword. You got to read and open it. Satan would believe, I got a King James Bible. Yeah, I do. Do you read it? Well, no. So what? What's the matter then? Weaken the nation. By the way, the NIV note for this verse, that Son of the Morning, makes Lucifer Jesus Christ. Do you know that there's a religion out there, and I forget if it's the Jehovah's Witnesses or the Mormons, one of them makes Jesus and Lucifer brothers? Yeah, brothers. Satan and Jesus are actually brothers. And Satan's upset because dad is mad at him and not mad at Jesus. It's a story of Cain and Abel. All over again. And Satan's great, miserable anger is that the other brother, the prodigal son, is getting all the credit. And I mean, you know, I didn't get no calf. I didn't get no party from my friend. That's a damnation story out of hell that you don't believe in. For thou, Lucifer, hast said in thy heart. Uh-oh, Lucifer has a heart. And he talks. Some churches that sing, and he walks with me, and he talks with, they're not singing about Jesus, they're singing about Lucifer. I'm talking about Baptist churches. On my way to work and from work, I don't know how many miles it is, but from Daytona Beach all the way down to Daytona Shores, there's a lot of churches. And I am quite shocked to see on many Baptist signs during this Holy Week that we've had, Catholic holidays being shown on their billboards. Good Friday, Mandarin Wednesday, Fat Tuesday. On Baptist signs, Roman Catholic holiday. You don't have Jesus Christ in your church. He's outside knocking. I will ascend into heaven. Job 1, Job 2. But that's not the finish. He goes there, Job 1, Job 2. Here he's talking about, I'm going to go there and I'm going to dethrone God. He believes that. Satan believes that. Satan also believed that he could have turned Jesus to worship him. Matthew 4, Luke 4. Why would he even try if he didn't believe it? In the eyes of Satan or Lucifer, he believes he's going to dethrone God, and he also believes he could have got Jesus. He would never try if he did. I don't think Satan wastes his time. It's too valuable for him. He knows Revelation 12 is coming. He knows his end is coming, the Bible says. He's not going to waste his time when stuff is not going to work. There are Christians out there. He's not going to use beer and wine to get you. He knows you have nothing to do with that. So he will use the tool that will go against you and God. And if smoking cigarettes, it won't break you between God and you, he's not going to use cigarettes. If you don't cuss, he's not going to use cussing. But there's something in your life he's going to use to try to dethrone God in your life. Because the first commandment is God is to be first. God is to be sitting on the throne. Not you or not anything else. His main objective in your life as a Christian is to take God off the throne and put whatever else he puts in your life to be sitting on that throne and you to be worshiping. That is his charge. Before man fell. This is before man has ever was created yet. This is Genesis 1:1, and between Genesis 1:2 we're reading. You are reading the modus operandi, or whatever you call it. You are reading what Lucifer wants in your Holy Bible. You are reading what Satan said. I, Satan, will exalt my throne. Uh-oh. Satan has a throne. Did you read what John said to two of the churches? Revelation 1, 2, and 3. Where Satan's seat is. Satan, the Bible, King James Bible says, my throne above the stars of God. All right, those are star, literal stars, and the Bible says in Revelation, stars are angels. Lucifer wants to put his throne above God's throne, taking God off his throne. So Lucifer wants to look down from his position, see an empty throne, and see all the heavenly bodies and all the angels looking at him. That's what he wants. He told God in Luke 4, I will give you the nations if you fall down and worship me. Did he not tell God that? Well, the Jehovah's Witness, no, he didn't tell God, he told Jesus. No, that is God. He told God in Luke 4, fall down and worship me, I'll give you the nation. Get off that throne, get down on me, and lift me up. Didn't he mention the angels? If you, at least you kick your foot, I forget, what the, you know, the angels will protect you. Scripture with scripture. And you're going to beat old smutty face? I sat under a preacher. I don't know how many years. Old smutty face, I'm going to go in there with a water gun into hell. And, yeah. I didn't even dare when I left Connecticut to step foot in your church. Afraid something was going to crawl on me. You better watch out for Lucifer, Satan, and devil. He's a very powerful beast. And he thinks he's going to win. You know the worst person to ever deal with in life? When you've got a liar who believes his own lies, there's no hope for that person. When he lies and he believes it, and you talk to the person, and you're laughing inside. I will sit, also he says stars of God. He acknowledges they're gods. Look at that. He gives proper possession. Proper, listen, stars of God. How can they be the stars of God? God made them, right? Satan does not believe in evolution. Right there. Isaiah 14, verse 13. He does not believe in evolution because the stars are made of God. So he doesn't even believe in his own teaching that is taught in school, Romans chapter 1. Satan gives God the credit. Man won't. I will sit. So what's he trying to get Christians to do? Sit. Not stand. Not go. Sit down. You know the greatest tools that Satan ever made? A recliner, a couch, and a remote control. That has done more damage to Christianity and theater seats than anything else. You know, there were churches, I believe England, and I believe it came into parts of New England. I'm really not sure about New England. There were churches in England, there were no pews. You stood for the whole service. You know, in Ezra and Nehemiah, they stood when they opened the book of God, and they did not sit down. Satan says, I will sit. Also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. Satan in the Bible looks as to the universe, the earth, and all as a mountain. And over there in Psalms it says east, south, west, but God. It replaces north direction with God. I, Satan speaking, will ascend above the heights of the clouds. airplanes, satellites, rockets, space travel, where the eagle goes. Man's dominion is the highest mountain on this earth, and that's it. Eagles go higher than what man is supposed to go. So,
mission control, what do we have? We have the eagle has landed.
An eagle is an unclean bird. The eagle flew over Adolf Hitler and the destruction of the Jewish people. You can't escape the Bible. I, Lucifer speaking, will be like the Most High. Genesis 3:5. Education. Hey, Eve, I'll give you the knowledge. I'll give you all the knowledge that God has. God knows right from wrong. God knows evil from good. God knew about hospitals before the fall. He did not want Adam and Eve to know about hospitals. God knew about cancer before they were even created. God did not want man to know about cancer. So he ate that fruit. And man learned something about God. Death happens. Hell was made for Satan and his angels, Jesus said. It was never made for man. Yet, thou, Lucifer, shall be brought down to hell. Read the Bible. He reads the Bible. Satan knows the Bible. He has read he's going to hell, and yet still he told Jesus, fall down and worship me. Revelation 12 says he is angry. Woe to the people and inhabitants of the earth, because he knows his time is short. He knows. But he has no understanding. So let's change hell to something else, or let's say it's not real. If Satan goes to the grave and that's it, what kind of holy God do we have that he does not repay Satan for all the misery he's caused if he just dies and goes to the grave? That he does not suffer for everyone suffering from Adam and Eve. What kind of justice is that? What kind of justice is that for someone who destroyed families over and over and over for 6,000 years that he were to die and go into the grave? What kind of justice is that? That's a religious justice by a non-God. My God is holy and right, and he will throw the enemy who has destroyed men and women and children, he will throw him into hell. That's justice. And that's a warning. If you go against the God, this Bible, you will get your just deserts. And those that follow him will end up in the same place he is, verses 9 through 11. And verses 9 through 11, when he's cast into hell, they're all going to gather around him and say, you're just like us. You're a loser. In my book, anybody who is a loser, who does not do what God told him to do, and does not obey God, you're a loser. Losers are in hell. Losers are people, are Christians in heaven, who will walk around eternity without a crown. You're a loser. Yeah, you trusted Christ as your Savior. But you didn't do nothing for him. You served Satan. You sat down. You're a loser. You lost your crowns. That's what the Bible says. I'm quoting scripture. That you get the full reward. That you lose not those things that are given to you. So if you lose a crown, you're a loser. If you lose your soul and perish in hell like Satan and his angels, you're a loser. You lost your soul. You're a loser. That's Bible. I can say that. That's Bible. Satan loses it all. Everything. He sat there among the congregation, sat above God. He has seen things that I've never seen yet. And he lost it all. That's a loser. Satan, I say this by the grace of the Bible, of the King James Bible, of the Word of God, and that is because I know you can mess up my life. I know you can destroy me, but you can't destroy my soul. I know you can go after me. I know you can try to hinder me. I fear Satan with what what he can do in my life. But I still had the victory through Jesus Christ. You can't take my soul. But the Bible says, Isaiah 14, verse 15, you are a loser. And those people that go down the school bus, hail Satan, you don't know who your leader is. He's a loser. And I did not have to get to the end of the book to read it, but I've gotten to the end of the book. Revelation 19 and 20. He's in hell. And I am told before man is ever created, man, there is no man in Isaiah 14. We are between Genesis 1:1 and Genesis 1:2. You don't believe that? That's your problem. We are told before the creation of the recreation of all the animals and man and earth and the sun, the moon, the stars and trees and herbs and water and all that. We are told from the beginning, you're a loser. Satan, you are a loser. And you know what Satan wants? He wants more losers. He got a third of the angels. And then God created man one day, and Satan says, I want him too. And in one day, he's going to end up in hell, and everybody's going to come up to him and say, who do you think you are? You're nothing but a loser, just like us. And there's another place in the Bible that says that, you know what? He rejoices in those people that are in hell. While he's in hell. You're going to hear Satan in hell laughing as he hears everybody in torture. That's who you want to spend eternity with? That's who you want to follow? Don't you come to me, oh, God destroyed a bunch of people because of a typhoon. No. Because people could die in a typhoon and wake up in glory. There are missionaries over those countries over there witnessing people. They're getting saved. And they'll drown and end up in glory in the arms of the Lord Jesus Christ for all eternity. Then there are all the people who die and end up in this place here. In hell. Down to hell. Down. You go down. You don't get up. To the sides of the pit. And it's spoken like a big hole. They, paragraph, that see thee, Satan, who are they? Verses 9 to 11. Shall narrowly look upon thee. Can you imagine all man that is in hell looking upon Satan as he's cast in hell? Revelation 19:20. Hey, come here. What? Come here! Wow! What? Come here! There he is! Who? Satan! He's here! Yes, he's here! Look at him! Where? Right there! That's it? That's the one who put us in here? He's here with us? Yes, that's him. Well, who the hell does he think he is? If he's here with us? What's that big commotion? What's going on? Where are we going? And there they will be, Revelation 20, standing before God. Death and hell has been given up to the dead. They will see Satan in hell, and next thing you know, they're going to face God that created them. And their next spot is into the lake of fire. That's his pump. As they all line up before God as they're cast in the lake of fire for all eternity. That is hell. He's not in hell today. He's on the earth. Job 1 and 2, he goes up before God. He's the accuser of the brethren. And consider thee. Wow. That's it? Saying, is this the man? How much of an invitation is he? Herod said, behold the man, God, Jesus Christ. The people in hell, is that the man? The Antichrist. Receive his mark, 666. Oh, Satan rules, 666. Behold the man. There's your leader. There is the one that you wanted to worship. Burning with you. He's no better. That made the earth to tremble. I thought God did it. I thought God caused those mean, nasty earthquakes. Who killed all of Job's animals? Who killed all of Job's children? Who killed, destroyed Job's land? And yet, Job did not charge God foolishly. That did shake kingdoms. Well, who had wars? Who destroyed it and brought down kingdoms enough? Satan did. He had part of it. God, Satan, and man has part in problems. How would he destroy or shake down kingdoms? He found someone else who would give him more reverence than the previous king. Read history. There are kings that went in and destroyed and devoured and probably gave Satan more worship than the previous king. That made the world, not the earth, the world. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the whole wide world. Yeah, he does. Don't sing about God. For God so loved the world, not trees, not rocks, people. That made the world as a wilderness and destroyed the cities thereof. That opened not the house of his prisoners. Once you go into the devil's prison, except for Revelation 20, he'll never let you out. You know how many times recorded in the Bible that someone died and God said, okay, come back to life? That's God letting them out of the prison. Death. Come on, Lazarus, come on out. Get out of that prison. Show the world my power. You know, Lazarus is going to be resurrected again. You know, I may die today, tomorrow. My body will be resurrected. Paul, Peter, James, and John, their bodies are going to be resurrected one day. You can't hold us in prison. All the prison breaks in the book of Acts by God, going to happen again. I've got family right now that are in death. They've died. And I miss them. 1 Thessalonians or 2 Thessalonians, forget which one. Chapter 4 says, God shall call them out. God is so holy, he's going to raise those that are in hell, not Satan. Revelation 20. He's going to call them up out of hell, but they're only going to get them into the lake of fire. What a loser chapter. And that yet the Bible says many will go this way, the broad way, and few will enter the straight gate. And the few that do go through the straight gate, the fewest of them will do what God actually tells them to do. That's what's saddening. That's how much power Lucifer has. Too many people will be damned into hell. Some will get saved. And too many of those that get saved won't do nothing at all. They'll sit down. And Isaiah 14 tells you something that happens between Genesis 1:1 and Genesis 1:2, long before God said, let there be light, let there be a big sun in the sky, stars and all that. Let there be rhinoceroses and giraffes and gorillas and tomatoes and onions and radishes. Long before there's in Egypt, America, Asia, long before Antarctica, North Pole, long before Mount Ararat, long before Death Valley, long before the Mississippi River, long before the Congo, and all before that, we're reading about. And we are even told at that time that this being called Lucifer, the fallen being, loses. I believe, and this could be wrong, what you're reading right now, verses 12 to 17, when Jesus said that hell was made for the devil and his angels, I believe that this is when hell was made. At this point, he fell. That's what I believe. I believe there was a place called hell at this point. I don't think it was ever before this point. I believe hell starts right now, at this point we read today, and goes off to the lake of fire for all eternity. And it was made for Satan and his angels before man was ever created. And God so loved the world, he told man, you better not eat that food. Because you're going to die. The wages of sin is, here it is. So when we go on the streets, when we pass out gospel tracts, we go knocking on doors. We are trying to get people not to go away to Satan. We are trying to get them to go the way, the truth, and the life. Because I rather see God. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. I'd rather meet the Father in heaven by the way, the truth, and the life than meet the Father by this way. The way of hell. Because I'll meet an angry God at this room. I'll meet the loving God by the way, the truth, and the life.